Computing.
Who? There a context? Oh, I don't know. I've heard the phrase before. I don't know what it means.
It's just a yes or no question.
Like, are you one of those? Is that maybe I'm kind of thinking if it's like
Oh, it's not a yes.
like a pre-pharmacy program might be a pre-professional program for the pharmacy school, pre-med. So
Yeah.
maybe you're a biology major looking to go to med school, something like that. You're not changing out of computer science, are
No,
you?
no, I haven't. I
You're
just never
changing
put
into
it.
computer
I've never
science?
put it in
Oh,
there
I
since
see.
I realized that.
Got it.
I mean, I was going to do it,
Got it.
but I can't see it on my degree work.
Yeah,
That's
because
what's putting it off.
DegreeWorks is always accurate.
Yeah. Well, I like the old one better.
That old one didn't work either.
What? It's like
It
the you can see it.
doesn't work for any of our CS scholars students who are doing a bachelor's and a master's at the same time because it shows their undergrad stuff but won't show the grad classes they've taken.
Graduate. Like if you're a graduate, just here you're going in. Is there a degree works for you?
Oh yeah. Yeah, if you're a master student, you'll be coded as a master student, so it'll show your stuff.
I thought they said like graduate courses don't ever show up.
Oh, they won't show up for you. You
Okay.
got to go in and click some magical buttons and put in a thing. It's stupid. All right. So let's see, where are we at now? So we got our dungeon. We said populate our dungeon, and that's inside here. Populating our dungeon builds all the exits, links stuff up, yada yada yada. Then we build our player. So the next thing to do is put our player into the dungeon. And maybe for the moment, just so we can get some stuff showing up, why don't we teach a room how to display itself? So we can ask the current room we're in to show us its stuff. All right, where a room has a let's just have it display the name for right now. We'll keep it relatively simple. So we'll have a public void display. And inside here, we'll just say something like system.out.println. We'll say room this dot name. So it'll say, entrance, whatever we called it, hallway or E1 or E2, well, whatever. It'll show us just the name of the room we're in, and with the idea being as we traverse through the world, the other things will pop up. We'll throw some monsters in here soon as well. Go ahead.
So, how do you know, like, what should, describe what, or, like, what should, like, know about what, like, okay, so you're saying that the room is very, like, bringing to, like, tell the user about itself,
I would phrase it that the room has the ability to display itself, whatever that means.
why not? Don't
And maybe we would, but so the idea would be is as I envision it, a player is going to have a current room. So a player is standing inside of a current room. So they might want to have a function like look. So if a player looks around, he's going to ask the current room he's in, display yourself. And it's going to pop on the screen the name of the room. You could do this in different ways. You could have the dungeon basically go and, tell this player about this room and have that guy connect the dots. Okay. But this is really more of an object-oriented mindset where you think about, the dungeon and the rooms and the player and the exits. You think about all those and, kind of on stage. We start thinking about things in Unity, lingo. Unity calls things a scene. Okay. And then we have actors on the scene. So if we're currently in the computer science dungeon, right? So we walked into the dungeon. We are a player. That's, entered the scene, right? We're a player, and we traverse through the scene by going from room to room to room by the way we've described it. It's almost like a Lego version of this, right? And each time we take a step from one room to another room, the room magically kind of says, this is where you currently are. This is where you currently are. So it's the room that can report information about itself. Okay, that might be helpful for us, right? So this isn't a right or wrong thing. It's more of a just decision-making thing of who's responsible for showing information about a room. Well, a room has all of its fields internally. So a room knows about its name. It knows about its exits. It knows about its players. It knows about its monsters. A room has all this information internally that might be what we would expect it to display upon asking a room to display itself. Therefore, since it has all the stuff, we might as well give him the responsibility to display all that stuff. Kind of make sense? It's not necessarily supposed to be easy for you yet. This is more of the object-oriented mindset as you build out your applications, you start, I mean, hopefully one thing you're seeing here is we kind of are allowing our dungeon to grow organically. You know, we created the most simplified version of all our objects and got them out there. And then as they started needing some abilities, we added some features to a room. We're going to add some features to a player so they can start walking around and stuff like that. We're going to add some features to a monster so they can, you know, magically move from room to room, that kind of stuff. So this has more to do with just a, you know, almost like you're playing with your G.I. Joes or something like that, and you, or Dungeons and Dragons at home, and you're actually moving things around, and who knows about what. So there really isn't really a right or wrong answer. It's what seems to make the most sense. Room has all the information about itself, so it would make sense to be able to ask a room to tell us about that stuff. All right, so we're going to assume for right now that displaying a room, when we ask a room to display itself, all it's going to do is show its name. All right. So if we go into dungeon and we tell a dungeon, let's just do a similar thing for dungeon. We say, dungeon, display yourself. When a dungeon displays himself, what will he do? He'll probably ask his starting room to display themselves. So that means if I am a dungeon and somebody asks me to display myself, I say, well, what does that mean? What are you expecting from me? Well, you probably want me to give you some information about my starting room. Now, I don't know a whole lot about my starting room because all those things were private fields inside of room. But I'll tell you what, room knows about those and he has access to those private fields. So from a dungeon's perspective, he's just going to say, starting room, go ahead and display yourself. And for right now, displaying just means print it to the screen. All right. So now back here in main, we can tell this dungeon cs.display. Okay, so we have a dungeon called CS. We then populate that stuff with our rooms and exits that we wrote last time. And then we'll go ahead and ask that dungeon to display itself. We've created our instance of player here, but we haven't done anything with it yet. I did it again. I need to hit refresh. All right, but will it let me save? I hit save. That remembered. Dungeon remembered. All right, so there's our dungeon displaying itself. Make sense? All right. So now we want to go ahead and maybe put the player in the room.
Yeah.
So that means a room needs to know how to have a player added to it. Now, we've kind of created the support here to have a whole collection of players in a room, even though for this implementation, we're probably only going to get as far as having one player in a room. All right. But initially, we instantiate our players to have up to 25 players in a room, but we make sure we keep track of how many players do we currently have in a room. So we're going to now teach a room how to add a player. Why do we need rooms to do this? Because these are all private fields. So the only thing that has access to the players is room itself. So we're going to add an ability, public void, call this guy add player. This guy will take a player P as a parameter. Yeah, we'll do it anyways. All right, so we'll say add player. Now we're going to go ahead and we're going to set this dot the players at bucket this dot current number of players equal to P. And then this dot current number of players plus plus. We just added a player to our array of players. So increment the number of players that are in this room. We added it to bucket zero. Now we have one player in this room. Make sense? All right. Now we need to teach Dungeon how to add a player. Because ultimately what we want to do out here in main is we want to say cs.addPlayer. We want to ask our dungeon to add a player. What does it mean for a dungeon to add a player? It means for that dungeon to grab its starting room and say, add this player to you. All right. So we're going to go into dungeon. We're going to write public void add player. This guy will take in a player as a parameter. And we'll say this dot starting room dot add player. So what does it mean for a dungeon to add a player? It means we want to add a player to this dungeon starting room. So we'll go ahead and hand that player off to this dungeon starting room. Okay. Now, if we really, really want to, here in player, a player has a name, right? That it inherited from inhabitant. So if we kind of look at old school MUDs, a lot of times you'll have, here's the room name. Maybe there's a description. We didn't write descriptions. And then it'll be like an also here. Here's the list of players. All right. So let's go ahead and expand upon our display room. Because right now, when I go ahead and run this, if we build a dungeon, we build our player, we add the player to the dungeon, and then we tell our dungeon to display itself. It's currently only going to show the room name. Because even though we have added the player to that room, our display method for room doesn't look at players. Go ahead.
So how many add players do you
have? I have one inside of room and one inside of dungeon.
Okay.
Yep. Because initially, current number of players is zero. So what does this say? It says take the player we're adding, put him at bucket zero in this array, and then increment the current number of players to one. Because now there's one guy in the room. So the next time around, if we were to add another player, this would say the players at bucket one is equal to this new player. Then now we have two players in the room. Make sense? Dungeon just passes the buck. A dungeon says, hey, if you want to add a player to a dungeon, where do we start them off? We start them off in the starting room. I'm sorry, right here. We start them off in the starting room. And we add that player to that starting room.
Okay. So, like, what's the having add players here, like the method here and in the room.
If I'm out here in Maine, where my player was born, he doesn't know about that starting room. If you ultimately want to put the player into the computer science department, what you mean is I want to put him at the entrance of the computer science department, the main starting room. He doesn't, out here, P does not know about that starting room. Who knows about it? The dungeon does. The dungeon, we say, dungeon, please add this player, whatever that means to you. The dungeon says, what that means to me is I'm going to grab my starting room and I'm going to hand this player to him and say, add this player. What does that mean to the room? The room says, okay, I have this collection of players. I'll go ahead and take that player and I'll put him into my collection of players and keep track of the number of players that have gone into this room. So we're just kind of handing the buck. Almost like we have, you know, it's like going to any store or something, and you have like two or three people that you need to work with to accomplish a task, right? You know, like here, if you're doing like a Kohl's pickup, here's my, this is the thing I'm picking up. Somebody takes it, goes to the back. Maybe they hand it to someone else. I don't really do that at Kohl's anymore, but you know, so on and so forth. It takes two or three different steps in order to finally accomplish the task. All right. So right now it just shows the room entrance. Even though we know the player's been added to that room, we now need to upgrade our display method for room to also show the players that are there. So we'll do something like system. Actually, let's do this. Build our player string. All right. So we effectively want to build a string that is player names with a space after them, even though we know right now we're only putting one player in there. All right. So we're going to create a string, player string. We'll start that off as the empty string because we want to build up that guy. And then we want to loop through all of our players. So we'll say for int I is equal to 0. How many players are in the players?
Here's what I found.
Thank you. This is ChatGPT. Says there's one guy in there. All right. Current number of players. Okay. This was a design decision we made. In Java, arrays can report how big they are. How big? If I asked the players to give us his length, what would the result be? 25. How many players are actually in the room, though? One at this point. Started off as 0, right? So I've effectively given myself kind of a big bench waiting to hold players. It could hold up to 25 players. And at this point, I've only put one guy on the end of that bench. So I need to use my variable current number of players to keep track of how many players I need to zip through in order to find the players in there. All right. So I'll say this dot. Oh, current number of players, thank you. I++. So this will loop through all of the elements that are actually associated with players in our player array. And what we want to do is we want to add to our player string the name of the current player. Well, whatever the player string currently is, concatenated with the name of the current player, concatenated with a space. So we'll say Mike space, and then there's more players, Dave space, so on and so forth. So there'll be a little magical extra space there at the end. We want to call trim, we can get rid of it. How do I get the name of the player found at this dot the players at bucket I? That will boil down to an instance of the player class, correct?
Yep.
How do I get the name of an instance of the player class. Remember, a player comes from an inhabitant. Okay, why won't dot name work? It's private. Okay, dot name won't work because this guy's private. And actually, it kind of doubly doesn't work, right? If I say, if I say dot name here, If I say dot name here, I'm saying player, tell me your name by just trying to directly access the field. Well, let's go look at player. From player's perspective, he didn't even create that field. The field that this player got, it inherited from inhabitant. It is inhabitant that built that field called name. Well, a player does have a name, but he doesn't have the right to change his name because inhabitant has set name as private. So that means name is only accessible inside of inhabitant. I remember our rule of thumb is set fields to private first and then loosen the reins a little bit as we need to. Sounds like maybe we need to. right. Our player, he can indirectly set the name. We indirectly set the name for this player by having the constructor for our player call upon his parents' constructor. His parents' constructor is the constructor in inhabitant, which does have access to this private field. So indirectly, a player could do that. All right. Now, if we want to, we can put I'll set a public function here. Public void set name. This is inside of inhabitant. All right. So since inhabitant's the base class, and we have a public function inside of here called set name, player will get its own copy of that set name. So now we'll come into room and we don't want it to be set name. We want it to be get name, right? Sorry. Well, setting the name is, I guess, not a horrible idea, but maybe we don't want to let them change their name. Return this dot name, and now our return type is string. So we've taught inhabitant how to return its, in read-only format, its private field called name. All inhabitants can do that. And because a player is an inhabitant, he gets this function. Okay? So we're going to go back to room here. As we're spinning through our current players, we're building up our string. We want to call get name here. Does a player have a function called get name? He does. Why? Because a player inherited from inhabitant, and inhabitant has a function called get name. Came with it. All right. So let's finish this part up and then talk about it. So inside the display, we went through and we built up our player string, which is going to have the name of all our players, presumably. Then we'll do a system.out.println, maybe an also here, concatenated with player string, like that. Also here is Mike. Yep. So for display, this code right here, starts with the empty string and just spins through our list of players, grabbing each one's name, putting them next to each other with spaces in between. Now, what if, I think we've done it the correct way here, but what if we decide, you know what, maybe we never actually want to get the name of an of a monster, for example. We probably do, right? We're probably going to be interested in the rat's name, for example. That's why we put the get name at the inhabitant level, so both players and monsters get it. All right. But remember, we don't have direct access inside of player to the name. I can't say this dot name is equal to blah here in the constructor for player. Screaming at me. Name has private access in inhabitant. Player internally does not have access to that. Let me just show this real quick. I'm just going to take this function, get name. I'm going to move it from inhabitant, and we're just going to put it into player. I'll get rid of this error message right here. Why is that an error? Because name is a private field inside of inhabitant, and I'm currently in a class called player. That's why it's an error. Even though player is an inhabitant, we're not currently in the class called inhabitant. So similarly, if I decide, you know what? I don't want all inhabitants to be able to give us their name. So instead, I'm just going to teach players how to give us their name. And what are we going to do inside a player? We're going to return this.name, the exact same code as we had before. He doesn't like it either, for the same reason. What's the reason? Inside of player, I'm trying to return this.name, which has private security settings inside of inhabitant, which means we can only access it inside of inhabitant. Super. So you want to say, yeah, I understand what you want. You want to say that. No, because we are currently inside the player class, and that's only accessible inside the inhabitant class. Let's call that 99% sure. We'll run it real quick. I expect it to scream. Yeah. All right. So it's consistent. If it's private, you can only access it inside that class. Now, we did see a little bit of a magic trick there, though, right? When we had this function, when we had that inside of inhabitant and player received access to that, a player could then access it because technically it was the inhabitantness of the player that was having access to that private field. A player still could not directly get to that variable if they wanted to change it. But really what's happening here is when I had get name, so if we take this, I'm going to put it back inside of inhabitant. So we're going to see how, remember what we talked about this last semester. We said all variables resolve to their most local definition, right? When we were talking about variable scope, same thing's true with functions, methods, all right? So right here, when I say, this is an instance of player, I say get name. The first thing we're going to do is we are going to look inside of the player class for a function called getName. I go into the player class. Do you see a function in there called getName? No. So this comes down to how it actually works. Since player is an inhabitant, does he get a copy of all stuff that inhabitant defined? Well, we already know that's not, well, we know that's probably not the case because we didn't have access to the private fields. But he actually doesn't get access to all the stuff that inhabitant defined. Instead, he gets access to the instance of inhabitant that is his parent. So when we are right here and we ask this player to call his getName function, and Java tries to resolve that, and it goes into player and says, where is there a getName function? There isn't one here. Should I throw an error because I didn't find one? Or are there other places to look? There's other places to look, right? Where? Inside of inhabitant. An inhabitant does have a getName function. Make sense? All right. Let me take that one step. So now we found it. It resolves it. It calls inhabitant's version of getName, which does have access to this dot name. Let's take it one step further to prove our point. Instead of calling getName here, I'm going to call toString. All right. What do we expect our output of this program to be now? Since I'm calling toString on this player object. Memory address thingy. Okay, so I run this. It's not going to give us the name of this player. It's going to give us the memory address of that player. Okay, so let's follow the yellow brick road again. First thing it's going to do is it's going to look, because we are dealing with player right here, right? That's an instance of player. I'm going to say, call your toString method. It's going to come in here. It's going to say, is there a toString method in here? Nope. Am I out of places to look? Nope. Where do I look? Inhabitant. Is there a toString method in here? Nope. Am I out of places to look? Where can I go now? Object. Remember, there's this invisible thing up there called extends object. And the object class does have a toString method. Oh, no, it would be a different memory address. It's a good question. Yeah, because super is his own instance of inhabitant, which would have its own memory address. Not that you would really ever use that in Java, but it is a true statement. Well, I'm lost of those errors. Object. So here's our object class. We scroll down and you say, is there a toString method? Yes, there is, right there. Class method or instance method? And how do you know? Instance method, why? We don't see the word static there. So how do we call this? We call it using an instance of the object class. Is this guy an instance of the object class? Yeah. He's an instance of the player class, which is a instance of the inhabitant class, which is a instance of the object class. So three levels up, his grandparent is an object, right? Okay. Kind of makes sense how we walk this hierarchy now. Well, so what he's talking about here is we said this dot the players dot length. We actually get the length of an array this way. What kind of animal is that? It'll boil down to an integer, but it is in terms of objects. This guy must be an object because he can do stuff, right? He's not just a primitive type. because it looks like this, is this guy a field, a constructor, or a method? It's not a method or a constructor, right? How do you know? No parentheses thingies. Okay. So I don't see parentheses. He must be a field. Okay. He is a final field of the array class, which is the base class for this guy. Because you can't go in and just say, well, your length is now 7. It's not going to be happy. So they won't be happy if you change it that way. You have one opportunity to set the length. And it was right here. No, actually, it was right here for that guy. All right. But point is we're accessing it as a read-only property. And we know it must be a field because there's no parentheses. That's the kind of animal it is. You know, we identified it in the wild, kind of like at the zoo. All right. All right. Make some sense? All right. So we're going to leave the get name inside of inhabitant. Make sure it's not still inside of. I was getting ready to show something here. I'm going to go ahead and move get name back into player. Then I'm going to go into room, and we're no longer going to be calling toString. We're going to now be calling get name. Okay. It's going to scream at us again, right? Because player's get name tries to access the name directly, and name is a private field inside of inhabitant. So this is going to give us an error saying you don't have access to this guy. And this is where our third security measure comes in. Well, I could, if, you know, this is kind of more of a beginning programmer approach. And, you know, sometimes you're trying to get some code out the door and nothing else is working. You could just say, just kind of come in here and do that. Well, if you delete it, if you take this guy off, what's his security? Package level, which means you can access it anywhere inside of the directory and anywhere inside the package. Okay. But we'll just make it public. Say, look, if you're interested, you got it. All right. Now it's going to be perfectly happy. You know, we've completely shattered our rule of start everything off as private and then loosen the reins as you will, right? Instead, what have we done? We just remove the reins. Just a go. All right. But what we can do, the appropriate thing to do here is to set its security level to something called protected. Protected says it's accessible inside of inhabitant as well as children of inhabitant. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and take off this extends object dealy here. Well, that's giving us, well, in this case, only player. But you could have a lineage much longer. We can have classes inherit from classes, which inherit from other classes, and so on and so forth. This exposes it to the lineage.
So a child.
Child or a grandchild or a great-grandchild. Yeah. It makes it accessible to the lineage. So that is protected. I want to say somewhere in here here's the security thing. I introduced it here, protected. So this is only accessible from within the class itself or children of the class. Does that make sense? Protected actually has a couple of other caveats to it, but I'm not going to throw that in there right now. For all intents and purposes, it does what I just described. All right. Okay. So we'll make it protected now. And now that it's protected, we will have access to it inside of player because player is an inhabitant. So I think it looks like I already ran it. So it's no longer going to be upset Actually, I think it ran it when it was public. Yeah. Now you see it also works when it's protected. Like, go ahead.
Access, do you mean read and write?
Right now it's read and write because that's at the field level, right? Typically, and this is why I say make it private and only loosen the reins if you need to. Put it on complete lockdown. And if you want somebody to have read-only access to it, throw a getter inside of an habitant. We call this a getter. It doesn't have to be named this, but getters typically are get, whatever the field name is. Historically, these were called accessor functions. So if you want to put a little comment, getter for, and I'll put it in parentheses, accessor for read-only access to the private field name. So nobody can change name through that function, but they can request the name from that function. This is probably the most correct because we have two kinds of inhabitants. We have players, we have monsters. Seems like it would be helpful to have the name of both of those dudes, right? As we're going through our dungeon. So we'll go ahead and put that getter at the inhabitant level. We'll keep name as private, so we can only access it at the inhabitant level. And whenever we need to get the name, we'll access it through the ability given to us by the inhabitant. All right.
It doesn't have the parentheses, so is it mean something different than just protected and getter?
It actually is doing something different. Arrays are primitive types, but they're objects, kind of like strings. So for lack of a better explanation right now, it's done something special to give final read-only access to a field, which is they're called properties. It's a flag at runtime. All right, I want to show you one more thing real quick so I can give you your assignment. We're going to have a scanner input is equal to new scanner. It is easy. I'm going into great details. So we're going to say system.out.println. Enter your name. And we're going to say string name is equal to input.nextLine. System.out.println name. Yep. Oh, it's in java.util. Ninja. Import java.util.scanner. Enter your name. I'll say Mike. It echoes it back to me. All right. So for your homework, so now inside this code, I've shown you how to read strings in from the user. So homework. Allow, let's see, given this, perfect, share, given this guy, allow the player to move around inside the dungeon, showing the room contents, well, let's just say asking the room to display itself upon entering it. Submit a link to a code and the self-assessment. You can, but I'm not requiring it. Basically, for this, I want you to allow the player to run around. Questions, comments, concerns, bribes? All right. I'll see everybody on Friday. We actually are. I need to ask Emily for those. Thank you for reminding me. I just don't want to miss.